call to order. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome to the Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's County on Thursday, July 9th at 1 p.m. I'm going to do some quick introductions. To my far right is Susie Wilden. She's our recording secretary. Next to her is Corporal James Stone, our enforcement officer. Attorney Jim Tanavage, board representative. Our administrator, Tammy Hildebrand, member Leonard Cole. Over to the left, our inspector, Garland Thompson, member Kevin Hall, member Miss Betty Curry, our vice chair, Linda Palczynski, and I would be your chair, Ted Bellavoine. It's a pleasure to serve you, and we will get started with a approval of the minutes. Do I have a motion to accept the minutes from 5/12/16?
I make a motion that we accept the minutes from Thursday, May 12, 2016.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? The only discussion on the minutes is a small
typo
located on the second page. We're going to change many to May, and I've alerted Ms. Hildebrand of that.
Where is it? Second page.
Going to be. Actually, my mistake. Fourth page, second paragraph, or number two. It says Board Administrator Tammy Hildebrand. Paragraph two. The last sentence reads, "The new rules and regs will be sent out as many legislation changes made as possible, but a letter will be sent to explain more legislative changes may follow, not many."
Okay.
That was it. Okay.
Thank you.
We were just overwhelmed with how many changes were coming, so many was on our minds.
With that one caveat, we'll approve that. We do have an announcement, if you'll bear with us for a moment. We have a member who has ended service with the Alcohol Beverage Board, Mr. Aaron Mathis.
Before you do that, sir, we need to take a vote on your minutes.
There we go.
He's new. We'll get him, bro.
There we go. All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried. Now can we get to Mr. Mathis? I see him in a room. I'm ready to go. Mr. Mathis, if you would stand forward. Are we all coming to come up here? Want to try and get a photo with Mr. Mathis?
Board members, please.
Board members? We come over here, sir. Mr. Aaron Mathis, in recognition of your outstanding performance and dedicated service as a member of the Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's County, from October 27, 2011 to June 2, 2016, I'm your board members. I want to thank you very much, sir, your service.
All right, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Good
Miss all y'all, and I know you'll be in good hands, the new chair. Definitely, she's the key.
Don't tell them that. Thank you.
Thank
Aaron.
You for your time and service.
Right.
Next on the agenda is old business, and it's going to be Big Dog's Paradise Bar and Liquor requesting a 60-day extension of their conditional approval for the extension of premise for the walk-in box.
Brian. Yeah.
Is there a microphone?
No, there's not. I think, Brian, you'll have to... I don't know how she's doing this. How'd she do this last time? Because the mic was gone last time, too.
It still picks it up, I think.
Yeah.
Does that one work over there?
Right there.
Okay.
You would raise your right hand.
Well, do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth? Thank you. You can have a seat and talk loud.
Sir, if you would, identify yourself by name and your home address.
Brian Lewis Athens, 39186 East Cusick Court, Mechanicsville, Maryland, 20659.
And what can you tell us about the request for your extension?
Well, obviously this thing has been ongoing, so I'm asking the board for another extension. We just had some an issue. The last board meeting we had an issue with MedCom. We resolved that. Then there was a small part of the, I guess the, a hold on the approval of the permit that was overlooked by, I guess, planning and zoning, that fire marshal had a note in there about a fire-bearing wall. They wanted to make sure there was a fire-bearing wall. Nothing was going to be approved until they could, you know, prove that there was one, isn't one, and they wanted basically a, by law, the codes, a suppressant sprinkler system if there wasn't. So that was overlooked for all these months. So communicating with the fire marshal's office was, I mean, it was horrible. It was just hard to get in touch with the proper people, or the proper person, I should say, after voicemails and emails, to the point where it just had to go up the ladder. And then I finally did get hold of him, and he wanted me to check the wall, which I did. And there is a fire-bearing wall. But so they did go ahead and pull their hold, but not because of the wall. So there was a five-month hold on this thing for them just to go ahead and lift the hold because of the lean-to roof was such a small area. So that's why we're here. So with that being said, the permit has been picked up, so we're ready to proceed. I just need the extension to go ahead and finish and be done with it.
You feel comfortable you'll meet your deadline within 60 days?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. Anything else?
Nope, that's it.
It's not conditional.
We're just waiting for fire marshal approval.
Yeah, you don't have to add that in. You're just giving him a 60-day extension of that conditional approval, correct?
All right. Do we have a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the request for a 60-day extension of the conditional approval for the extension of premises for a walk-in box for Big Dog's Bar and Liquor.
You have a second?
I second.
Any discussion?
I seconded. I'm sorry.
Linda.
Thank you.
Linda.
Sorry.
That's okay.
No discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried. Thank you, sir.
Good luck.
Good luck.
Appreciate it.
Take care of.
The next order of business is applications. It's going to be for 5 South Event Center. Application of Joseph or John Joseph Winters to transfer the Crystal Room D&H Properties Class B restaurant, BWL license from Hilda Mae Gatton, and upgrade to a Class D license, trading as 5 South Event Center, 5 South LLC, 21030 Point Lookout Road, Callaway, Maryland, 20650. That would be you, sir?
That's me.
Please raise your right hand.
Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. Have a seat.
You would, Mr. Winters, state your full name and your home address for the record.
Oh, John Joseph Winters, 21020 Lightfoot Way, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650.
Mr. Chairman, this will be a conditional approval because John's still waiting on his inspections for the building.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mr. Winters, what can you tell us further?
So we are requesting a transfer of the existing Class B license and an upgrade to a Class D, 7-day Class D. Property locations 21030 Point Lookout Road, Callaway, Maryland, 20620, formerly the Crystal Room. Current licensee is Hilda Gatton, and we are seeking a conditional 90-day approval to get our county inspections. I am the licensee with the address, home address stated. That address is 1.5 miles from the event center. I was born in Leonardtown, Maryland, 46 years old, and I've been a county resident my entire life. registered to vote since 1988. I've held a liquor license in St. Mary's County for 15 years. It started with Monk's Inn in St. Indigo's, Maryland, 1998 to 2008. Twist Wine and Spirits in Lexington Park, Maryland, 2010 to 2015. And the Lime Lounge at Twist Wine and Spirits, Lexington Park, Maryland, 2015 to 2016. I'm SurfSafe alcohol certified, valid through January 4th of 2018. The business entity for this event center is Five South Event Center, LLC. It's a limited liability company, and I'm the sole owner with 100% interest. The property ownership is the Shops at Five South LLC. I'm also a member and owner of the property and the resident agent for that LLC as well. The property itself is 7.75 acres. It's zoned VMX, which is Village Mixed Use. It does have an adjoining parcel that's RPD. It's served by public water and sewer. There's a fire hydrant on site, and the conference center or event center is wet fire sprinkled and monitored with an alarm. It has 228 parking spaces on the property. The event center itself is 11,000 square feet of a total of 30,000 square feet in that shopping center. Capacity is 599 with the fire marshal, and seating is at 500 with Metcom. The event center itself requires 167 parking spaces. We do have, or I have in hand, our approved sign permit to put an electronic LED sign out front, and our minor site plan has been, all the comments have been satisfied, and it's being sent to the final signature person for the final signature. With the event center, Five South itself is never going to run its own events or promote its own events. It's strictly a rental facility for any type of event, from a banquet to a wedding or a reception or a meeting, conference. Our staff will, however, have to provide all of the alcohol sales, as well as any security services will be provided only through Five South. So our alcohol management plan, we're going to work towards having any of our bar staff members, TAM or ServSafe, certified. Three of the six that are potential bartenders or servers there currently have one of those certifications. We are going to do 100% ID checks and have the handheld devices for swiping identification cards at entries into the event center. Wristband systems, when applicable, that'd be determined on the type of event that someone's proposing to have there. We do have a written alcohol service training program, which will be available for viewing at inspection time. Anytime alcohol is served on site, I will have a bar manager there at the facility, obviously overseeing those operations. All alcohol will not be served at all events, obviously. We'll have a contractual agreement with anyone renting the event center that alcohol must be purchased and served by Five South Event Center, and no alcohol may be brought in on the property or into the event center in accordance with state and local regulations, so we'll have that well documented and signed in our agreement with any party renting the space. Our security plan, we will have security for all applicable events, and it will be only provided by Five South Entertainment Center, so no one will come in to produce their own event and provide their own security. It'll be our team. For events that require security, I have a security manager who will always be on site when security is required. The security manager, our bar manager, assistant manager, myself, will all be trained on the crowd manager program that's required through the State Fire Marshal's Office for venues of 50 occupants or more. We will have a written security program and plan on site as well. We believe that having a state-of-the-art modern event center such as this will fill a need that St. Mary's County does not have right now. Events including conferences, receptions, meetings, performances, shows, and more would bring hundreds of people into the area, hopefully each week. The businesses in and around the village of Callaway would be positively impacted by the increase in steady traffic to the area. And if I may, I had some copies for you guys.
Just go ahead and bring them up, John.
That would not have been good. Oh. So page 1 and 2 is a summary of what I just went over with the board. Page 3 is a overhead view of the event center itself with the tan roof in the center. Page 4 is a floor plan of the event center. Starting at the top of the page and working clockwise, you'll see the ladies' room, men's room, the bar area. The bar area has the ability to be completely sealed off if it's an event that does not want alcohol there. So you can close it and not even see that there's a bar area in the facility. And an event center office in the corner. The piece sticking out towards the back or the bottom of the page is the kitchen, prep area, storage area, and a side foyer. There's three rooms in the back that will make up the four rooms that are available at the event center to rent. And those rooms will be for smaller parties that don't require a 6,000 square foot space at whatever the fire marshal determines the capacity to be. My initial meeting, his estimate was 50 to 75 in those rooms, three rooms at the bottom. The fire marshal did require some plans on seating arrangements, so the next page is just to give the board a view of what a conference room seating might be set up as. And then there's two others, one for receptions and one for performance style seating. The fourth seating diagram is just a zoom in or a close up of the three rooms in the rear. And they just have a different theme, basically, to each of those three areas. The only bar area is the main bar in the event center itself. So all service would go through that bar. These rear rooms are interconnected through that side foyer right into the main hall area. The first map shows the village of Callaway. The yellow arrow indicates this property in relation to the Food Lion Shopping Center across the street and the Callaway Village Center closer to the intersection with the A&W and the Gridiron Grill. The following page is just a zoning overlay, and it shows you the VMX zoning of the front portion of the 7 3/4 acres, and then you'll see on the break in the middle is a SMECO right-of-way, and the RL in yellow towards the top of the page is the rear portion of the property that's residential, so that will most likely remain undeveloped. The last page is a mock-up of the existing freestanding sign that's out front, and the yellow arrow is pointing to the approved panel for the electronic LED sign. In closing, I'd like to thank the board for your time this afternoon and answer any questions that you might have.
Questions? Yeah, the alcohol storage, is it all going to be behind the bar, or is it going to be in any of these storage rooms, or?
The primary alcohol storage will be in the bar area itself because it is such a large area. So if you look at that floor plan, there's actually a powder room that's in the bar area. It's very efficient for your bartenders. But to the right and left of that, I anticipate storage area on either side and try to keep it all contained in that one room. I will have to add in a walk-in at some point in time, and that'll be a separate location of a refrigerated walk-in unit. And that would likely be in the room marked storage. I know this is, I apologize, it's smaller font and hard to read,
But your storage of alcohol is going to be at the bar, locked and secured in that location.
Locked and secured in that location.
You have three different kitchen areas, not in any one of those.
Not until that walk-in cooler goes in somewhere.
Okay.
And I'd imagine you have the kitchen to the left, kitchen prep. There's a storage room just off that kitchen prep area in the foyer. That's the location that I anticipate that walk-in going.
Future. That's in the future. Mm-hmm. And Tammy, that would come back to us?
No, because it wouldn't be increasing the square footage of the building. It's within the interior of the building, so he would not need to come back.
Okay.
How soon do you envision the walk-in being constructed?
Well, I'm doing the 90-day conditional. We have an event on June 30th, so that's right around the corner.
What is that?
I would imagine in the next 30 days.
Oh, okay.
30 to 45 days.
What is it you're having on the 30th?
It's a show. It's called Sam Groh and Drivin' Muzzy.
Sam Groh Band?
Sam Groh, G-R-O-W.
So this is going to be a concert hall too, right?
Yeah. She's
It'll have concerts. The ability to do concerts, absolutely.
He has a concert thing here.
Now, who will manage then the concert venue? Would that be, do you have an events company?
I have a separate events company.
Okay.
It's called Full Effect Live Entertainment Group.
Okay. Now, would Full Effect Live then lease from 5 South?
Exactly.
Okay.
Now, I am not looking to do a lot of my own promotions going forward. I expect to do a lot more on the front end until rentals increase. I would much rather rent the facility than produce and promote a lot of my own shows.
Right. Well, that was going to be my question as far as like nostalgia bands. Are we looking at something that's similar to Calvert Marine Museum here as an event center with nostalgia bands, Goo Goo Dolls, Marshall
the
Tucker.
The event center has the capacity to be able to promote and produce a show that can attract regional or national talent. Mm-hmm. So yes, mm-hmm. Not to the, you're talking probably a cap of $12,000 to $15,000 towards mm-hmm. An entertainment act in whole, mm-hmm. If it's multiple entertainers. So you're not going to attract. ZZ Top will not be playing 5 South. It'd be great.
But I do believe this venue would lend itself to a band like Marshall Tucker. There's a concert facility in Annapolis that, and I can't remember the name of it, but that does, and they've had Marshall Tucker. Same arrangement and everything else. $50, $75 a ticket to get in, and they serve alcohol, they've got food, et cetera, et cetera. And it's limited like this. I can't tell you what Marshall Tucker charges, but I'm sure it's a split of the gate, possibly. Mm-hmm. Some kind of guarantee, and then a split of the gate. So that's where I'm going with that. Those questions,
It can support something like that, mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Winters, you testified regarding signage in the parking lot and so forth. No alcohol coming in. That's also going to state no alcohol in the parking lot?
Correct.
Okay. You didn't say that. I just wanted, but that is what your meaning is, even though you don't want anybody bringing their own alcohol, but you're not going to allow any out the door and no consumption in the parking lot, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And the only reason I'm concerned about that is there are many entry points. What's your plan for the entry points?
So all of those entry points have the push bar to where the door can remain locked from the exterior, but you have the panic bar on the interior. Our security plan at any event would have a minimum of one staff member posted at each of the three main exits if the back rooms are not part of.
Well, I guess that's where I'm just looking for some clarification. I'm familiar with the facility. You have the front door, you have this rear door, but then all of the exit points out the rear that you may not be using, the green room or the stage room or the lounge, but that is an entry point that could get in through this foyer into the space, correct? What's your plan there?
If those doors would be locked from the outside.
Yeah. Do you plan on using the large space if you had a 500 person event and then the three lounges at the same time?
I don't anticipate double booking those areas. A larger event would possibly use one of those areas. The green room, for example, is set up as a green room. If you did have performers in there, a lot of their riders, they ask for certain things and certain spaces that you have to provide them But it would also lend itself to a bridal room, for example, if you had a wedding reception where, if you saw on the floor plan, it's primarily couches and mirrors and things like that where a bridal party could go, if they wanted to rent that a space additionally, could go to do their thing.
Well, now, you're saying that the green room is going to serve as your performer's lounge?
Correct.
And so, anyway, that's typically catered, multiple different, whatever they're requesting as far as alcohol is concerned and everything?
Yes.
Right.
Okay. The ones I've worked for, they give you a specific rider that tells you what they want.
Right, they might want 5 cases of Heineken and
M&M's, peanut M&M's.
And a half a case of Jack Daniels, you know?
Well,
With the mixers. Now, how would you provide that to the entertainers? That alcohol there, will you have somebody serving that for the entertainers?
We would have a portable bar in that space.
Would there be
that or a server that's just running, taking care of that room and running to the bar from a server standpoint?
Would you have a separate server in the green room?
Yes.
Because I envision that being more the case than,
yes,
you know, running back and forth to the bar. See what I'm saying?
It would either be a server, but if it's a server, they would run back to the bar.
Mm-hmm. But I see it as a separate bar in the green room, temporary type thing for that performance.
That possibility exists. Mm-hmm. My initial thought was the server, just serving to that area. Mm-hmm. That way we can keep everything contained in the one space.
But if you had somebody in the main conference room, the big room, and then you had something going on in the green room down here, how is the bar going to be serving down here plus taking care of the people up here in the main room?
Your server would run from the green room.
I mean, you have a stage left, a lounge, and the green room. The green room, you said, would be couches and that. So stage left means you can have a venue in there. Am I right? You can have entertainment in there, right?
Double booking, said.
Each of those.
You'll have double bookings going on. You got stage left, you got the lounge, and the green room, but then you have to go out to get to the bar. That's in the main big area. I'm just asking, how are you going to serve the people if they're attending something stage left and they're sitting in the lounge here?
They would be served through a server.
He's going to have to go out.
Just like any restaurant that has multiple rooms, seating rooms.
You have somebody taking orders and all that?
Absolutely. Correct.
But they would have to go back through the interior here to get to the bar.
They would have to go through that side foyer that's on the right-hand side.
Would they go outside to get into the bar?
No, the side foyer is an interior room.
Space right there.
The health department raised an issue on restroom facilities if you had folks in those smaller rooms. They each have their own, what you would call a powder room, but it's just one facility. So their requirement is to have those spaces accessible through the interior to where those folks can use the main restroom facilities that are out front. That's why. So everything's interconnected.
I would still like to go back to the contractual riders that you would have for a large band, let's say, you know, 4 or 5 musicians, and then possibly another 10 people that would be, you know, roadies, sound people, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And their rider and their contract is going to request that they have different types of alcohol, beer,
et cetera, as well as, you know, the M&Ms and sandwiches, et cetera, et cetera. So all of that then is served in the green room for that band and their roadies and everybody else. It would all be contained within the green room.
Correct.
Would all of that then be under your supervision as far as the alcohol is concerned?
It would, because we're serving through our service staff.
Okay. So you would assign separate service staff, actually set up a portable type bar there in the green room where these band members come up and get a beer or a drink or what have you?
I would probably lean towards them serving right from the main bar and not having a temporary bar back there. So they would just order, they would order their drinks just like anybody else would order their drinks, and the server would go to the bar, retrieve the drinks, and bring them back.
And then you would just tabulate however their, whatever the contractual agreement was on the amount of alcohol.
On the amount.
Yeah, right. Okay. My question then is, let's say now it's showtime. How are they going from, the green room to the stage area? Are they going to go out the back doors and come in on the side door over here?
That really depends who it is. If you had some national talent in there or ones that I've worked with in the past, they would likely go through that storage room where the set of staircases is,
mm-hmm.
and go out that opening and go in through the back door.
Now, there's an opening here on the other side of the storage, or is that a...
It's a roll-up garage door.
Oh, okay. Okay, so they could go that way and then enter on the side of the stage, correct?
Correct. And be hidden from the crowd or the guests. Or the...
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
John, I have a question. Who's paying for the alcohol for the band?
Full Effect Live.
I'm sorry?
The company that's promoting and producing.
So you will be paid for that alcohol?
Yes. Yeah, that's earlier. I mentioned Five South itself will never produce or promote any events. It would be someone else coming in.
You're the rental hall or the convention center.
Correct.
Is what you are.
I own an entertainment company, and I would have a contractual agreement just like anyone else with Five South, and that would be the entity that would
purchase the alcohol from
take care
Five
of the
South.
Performers and pay the performers and all that. Now they also have to pay Five South for security and the staff that's there. But Five South would strictly be rent. The income streams for Five South would be rent, primarily rent and alcohol sales.
Because mm-hmm. even though this is a little bit out of the box of a regular bar, because previous ownership it was out of the box of a regular restaurant, we have had a convention center in the county, the Dougherty Center at one time, so it's not completely off the chart. But you do realize, with this green room issue in regards to contractual, we require XYZ. You guys are still responsible for service. You're still responsible for over-service, so they have to understand that, and that will be part of that contract, correct?
Correct, and that's why I felt it best to split those and not have Five South be involved with anything other than focusing on the alcohol sales and security, mm-hmm. and being a rental facility, mm-hmm. and that's it.
Now, how will you control performers taking alcohol from the green room to the stage area?
Well, that would have to be under the security plan. The staff that I, or the security manager that's coming on board here, and much of the staff is the same security team that I had at the two Southern Maryland Brew and Barbecue Festivals that we've done. And, we entertained 6,000 people, over a weekend period.
Well, my concern is taking the alcohol then outside of the premises and then back into the premises again.
It's all one premise. It would all be considered one premise.
You'd have to control going out the door and in the back door.
Yeah, that would be allowed then.
No.
It has to stay within the walls of the facility.
Well, then that's my question is, you've got performers that want to take alcohol up on stage with them, okay? And they're in the green room.
Their crew would have to do that because they wouldn't get past the big guy with no neck that's at the door.
Okay, so
they'd have to have someone that's going to take it through, you know, the inside, or, you know, have some way of facilitating it where maybe it's already
on stage
or stage right or next to the stage or wherever they are before they actually go on to the stage.
What is the name of your events company again?
It's Full Effect. So it's F-U-L-L.
Yeah.
EFFECT.
Yeah.
Live, LIVE.
LIVE, okay.
Entertainment Group.
Is that LLC? Or
it's an LLC.
LLC?
Yeah, in the state of Maryland.
Okay.
Do we have any other questions from
the
board?
No, I just have one. So when you rent out the space and you're having a party and you control the alcohol, because the liquor, the bar is yours, right? That's what you said. Okay. So the bar is yours. You're leasing the business, the rooms. You control that. So any venue that goes on there, you have a conference for another, a party, a rave, or whatever, for 500 people. So everything that comes in there, you will be sole responsible for any alcohol that's outside, inside, any violation. You know that, right?
I do.
So you will be full responsible. That's yours.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's all part of our security plan as well. I've been in touch with the sheriff's department as far as on major events, with whether it's drive-throughs on the parking lot or standbys. The other big part that we're going to do to control that at those type of events is a no reentry policy. So, you know, this event's only for a 4 or 5 hour period. Doors might open at 7 and the event's at 8. And it's for 3 or 4 hours. So once someone comes into the event, there's a no reentry. So if they leave, they're not coming back in.
How about security lights and cameras outside? Any available?
There is no camera system there now. I will be adding
I think it definitely would need one in the parking lot and all that, yeah.
Absolutely.
And the exit doors. Okay.
So lighting and security is a big thing. And in talking with my security manager, you know, on larger events, I think the number we were at was, I think, 8, a minimum of 8 security staff, which would cover all exits and have, you know, some roving security people. And any larger events like this, we've always had some female staff members as well that can do the bathroom, you know, runs for us.
And do you have a cleanup crew available for outside? Any trash or anything that's being left?
It depends how much money. Right now, I'm the cleanup crew.
To keep it clean.
Now, if I make enough, you know, then we'll.
After an event,
we'll keep the place.
You'll have
clean.
God knows what you'll find out there.
Yep. So I've been to enough concerts that I know we need to keep people out of the parking lot and not do things that.
Just real quick. 500 for the main room, and you talked about the fire marshal and the other spaces. What's your maximum that you're looking at? What idea, what number do you think you would?
The crystal room has, the fire marshal has the crystal room at 599.
Okay.
The big room.
Right. But if you use the whole venue at one time, do you have that number?
It's likely going to be 599. So that's where it gets into probably not having the ability to double book these back rooms at the same time. And that's not a fire marshal thing that's actually a parking thing.
That's what they ask,
yeah.
So as you know, you have 6 different county agencies and you have to find out what all their requirements are, and then you have to go with the lowest possible number. So parking does have it. You know, has its limitation
on that
event center. Yes.
Sure. Okay.
Mr. Winters, Did this Crystal Room have this sort of live performances before?
I don't know what, I don't know the answer to that. I know that the Crystal Room has not done a lot in the last several years.
Wedding receptions, not.
In the past.
They were primarily set up for wedding receptions.
Yeah, in the past, they'd have weddings and corporate parties, as well as they'd have go-go bands play there as well. It was, again, very few and far between since I've been in alcohol.
The neighborhood hasn't, will they accept your live music sort of? Who did you say? Sam Groh? Because he's a big, to me, a big star, yeah. But the neighborhood hasn't complained at all?
I don't think so. There's not a lot of residences that are very close to this. If you look at that, overlay. So, and it's in the village mixed-use. It's in the village of Callaway, which...
I have not received any calls or letters.
Concerns?
After it was posted?
Yeah, nothing.
And because it's not an outdoor event, we can help, we can control that as well.
Mr. Thompson?
John, there, where you have the garage area, you said, has a garage door to it on the side here. Is that storage room right here, right? Is that when Ms. Gatton had locked up for someone that she used to have do some kind of thing there in that room?
Did she do something in there?
I mean, she had someone else that occupied that a little bit.
I think they had their just storage. They had a lot of kitchen pots and pans and shaving dishes.
They had that locked for because she said it was someone was in there that she had more or less probably ran out or something in that area one time there. So that's all ended now and everything, right?
That's all ended.
There is a stairwell there. What is that for?
Yeah. There's attic space above, so instead of a pull-down stairway, it just has a permanent set of steps, but okay. It's an unfinished attic space.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Winters, you've got parking capacity at 167.
That's not the capacity. That's the requirement for the event.
And that is represented by the aerial that you have here, the 167 spaces?
Well, there's 228 total parking spaces.
228 total. Okay, if you have an event that's 600 people, then you're talking roughly maybe three people per car, okay? And what I'm concerned about as far as the community is the overflow and parking over then in the Food Lion location. Have you approached Food Lion at all about, or the property owner as far as overflow on something like that, or the field that's adjacent to that?
I have not heard back from the property owner over there.
Okay.
I have reached out to the owner or the past owner at Beacon Liquors right there.
To Eric, reach out. Eric Ford?
Yes.
Okay.
To reach out. And get me in touch with
the property owner. I know that the property was sold, and I believe the property owner is someplace in Charles County. It's a family owned.
So that may be the delay.
Corporation. I don't know. My concern would be from a community standpoint is that after a major event such as this, the amount of trash or anything else that's left. So that we're promoting goodwill amongst everybody, and that we don't hear a bunch of complaints from Food Lion or anybody else as far as trash, all that sort of thing, or the parking, situation. That's a concern, but.
I had a similar situation at the lounge in Lexington Park. We've closed that and pulled that out, but parking was an issue down there as well. I mean, okay. It did meet all the criteria for the county, okay. But
what was your overflow in Lexington Park then?
Well, we reached out to the Golden Corral.
Okay.
And had an agreement with them.
Okay, so there wasn't an issue with that?
No.
You don't see anything with Food Lion or anything like that as far as overflow parking or anything?
I don't.
Okay.
And with this, with the site plan, I mean, there's 228 marked spaces, But there's a lot more area to park if there was over, you know, overflow. That just are, you know, unmarked areas of the property that with attendance out there on a bigger or larger event like that would be able to facilitate.
This photo is only representative of the sign, is that correct?
That's the current sign. It's there. I just overlaid, you know, our logo signage up top. And
oh, okay. So there is a, you know, it's the Hair Barn or Hair Bar.
You'll see that under the leasing.
And that is a current business there? The Hair Bar?
It's a hair salon. It's not a bar.
But it is there, right?
It's there.
Oh, cute.
There's four tenant spaces that are built out in there. And that gets into the parking with the 167 on the event center, because you have to make spaces available for the use of each of the other tenant spaces in there.
Where are they located? In the next little spot over where the barbecue place used to be?
They're on the opposite end of where Bear Creek was.
Oh,
the Hair Bar?
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions from the board?
I'm kind of curious if they already know the answer to this, but who's your security manager you keep referring to?
Anthony Thomas.
Okay. And
he's a past sheriff. You know Anthony.
You know Anthony.
Mm-hmm.
He's a good guy. Yeah.
And what's the name of the security company? Do you know?
It'll be Five South. Providing our own.
Okay.
Our security plan is just if someone comes in and wants to promote any type of event, they're not going to say, oh, we're going to bring our own security people in.
Okay.
We're going to know who it's our team and our plan, and so we can manage the whole event safely.
At the end of each application, I'm going to ask members, in that the board is done with questions, any members in the audience have any statements, any protest or support that you would like to offer for this application? Having heard none, do I have a motion?
Conditional on what?
This will be our first on a conditional transfer, which, as you recall, we changed the rules and regs to limit it to 30 days. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Pending anything?
Pending trader's license, occupancy permit, health department approval, fire marshal approval, so everything for the UNO. And then also the previous ownership needs clearance from the comptroller's office, which I'm assuming will probably take effect if there's, I don't know if you've heard anything back. I still haven't gotten a lift on that hold.
So this is conditional 30-day?
That's the most it can be. So if John runs beyond with his work, it's not completed within the 30 days, he will need to come back to the board in July and request more time.
Which means you don't have your event on the 30th.
That's a possibility.
Does that seem doable for you?
Absolutely. The operation, it's really a turnkey operation because the Crystal Room was, in a sense, operating. So it's really nothing more than cleaning and painting and changing light bulbs and satisfying the agencies.
I'd really like to see you guys at some point here with security cameras, you know, in the parking lot, and on the buildings, and the entrances, and the bar area, you know, wherever you have money, you know, that sort of thing. I'd like to encourage you to really pursue that too. Also, just as a means of if there is any kind of disturbance or whatever, that law enforcement then would have, you know, video to refer to.
I agree.
Waiting for a motion.
So Tammy, once again, we need the occupancy permit.
Occupancy permit and clearance from the comptroller for retail sales.
Okay, from the previous owner.
Correct.
And fire marshal approval still.
Yes, and I just want to ask one thing prior to your motion, my apologies. amusement taxes, because you are doing charging at the door, who's going to be responsible for that license?
Full Effect Live already has amusement tax number.
Okay, so in other words, your promoting companies who you're contracting with will be responsible for that amusement tax.
Absolutely.
And they'll file that, and you'll and Five South will verify that that's
correct.
In place. Okay. Sorry.
Similar to our at the fairgrounds, they mm-hmm. were the venue. Full Effect was the promotion company.
Okay.
And they verified with a some type of form.
Right. You have to send it in 10 days after the event. Correct. Okay.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt.
Is part of that amusement tax also the what's required for paying the Musicians Association for use of music?
No, that's another. That's a whole separate.
That's another one, right?
And there's three of them.
Okay.
There's three different ones. So.
Now, does any of that have to be reported?
That's why I'll be cleaning the parking lot.
Does anybody need to report that to the state? Is there any reporting involved in that?
No.
No?
They're okay. A private company that they reach out to you when they find out what you're up to. And,
right.
And they want their fee, their annual fee. So I have a relationship with all of those through okay. the lounge as well. The amusement tax is 10% of entry. If you're charging for entry.
And that's state, correct?
Comptroller, correct.
Comptroller, right?
State comptroller.
I make a motion to approve a conditional 30-day license for the Five South Event Center application of John Joseph Winters to transfer Crystal Room D&H Properties, Inc., Class B Restaurant Beer, Wine, and Liquors license from Hilda May Gatton and upgrade to a Class D Beer, Wine, and Liquor license and trade as Five South Entertainment Center, Five South LLC, 21030 Point Lookout Road, Callaway, Maryland, 20620, conditional on the trader's occupancy, health, fire, UNO, and clearance from the previous owner to comptroller.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Ms. Curry?
Yes, thank you.
Any discussion, further discussion for the board?
Well done.
This is our time to talk within ourselves. Yes, no? I think we've pretty much covered it. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those opposed? Congratulations, Mr. Winters.
Thank you.
Good luck, John.
Mr. Winter, yeah.
Stay in touch, John. Top line.
Okay, are we ready for the next one? Thank you, sir.
Of course, I'm not.
Okay, folks. The next order of business is Bottom of the Hill Tavern application of Michael Hicks to purchase a Class B restaurant BWL license, trading as Bottom of the Hill Tavern, Bottom of the Hill Tavern LLC. It's going to be 40874 Merchants Lane, Leonardtown.
Raise your right hand, please. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Have a seat.
Sir, if you would, give us your full name and home address, please.
Sure. Michael Albert Hicks, 41481 Miss June Court, Leonardtown, Maryland.
And Mr. Hicks, what can you tell us?
This will be my sixth restaurant, third liquor license in St. Mary's County. Originally from Prince George's County. Some people call us come downers, but we are love the area. Pretty much look forward to being back in the restaurant business again. I don't have any handouts. All kidding aside, Robin and I have run 6 restaurants and been very lucky, been successful. And we take very seriously the responsibility. We don't want minors in there to begin with. Let's say we're more interested in finding a friendly place for people of our, some of our age, as opposed to a younger crowd. And but we serve more food than we do alcohol anyway, predominantly food.
Do you currently hold the license?
Currently
hold one?
No, I don't. I still own a bar in Upper Marlboro, but I just rent it out. I have for years and years.
Property owner, not licensee, correct?
No.
Okay.
I'm not a resident of Prince George County anymore, so I couldn't be. But I've rented it out for 20-something years. So.
Any further?
No.
Any questions from the board on the application?
I'll be up and just closed Monday, Tuesday through Sunday, and 9 or 10. We're not looking. I mean, we'll stay later. We have nice people. Let's say this isn't our first go around, but we're not looking to be a late night crowd and little to no entertainment.
Dinner only?
That's not what we're looking for.
What time? Dinner only?
Pardon me, ma'am?
Just dinner hours?
Oh, no. We're open from 11 until.
Lunch and dinner.
I didn't probably say that right.
So 11 a.m. till?
Yeah, 9 or 10, or you know, sometimes later. But certainly we have no desire to be there till 2 o'clock in the morning. Unless it's really a fabulous day.
Mr. Hicks, can you tell us exactly where this is in Leonardtown?
Sure. It's been many things, starting as a Perkins, recently a Fosagon, in front of the McKays.
Used to be Perkins and whole list.
Yeah, numerous. Yeah. Everybody that visits, had many visitors in the 2 months we've been in there cleaning up, go through them all and how they've worked at all of them and been to all of them and things of that nature.
They've given you time to clean up?
We actually, Rob and I get there at 7 o'clock in the morning because we try to get things done before people start passing through. It's flattering. Support we've gotten from the community, just people coming by, can't wait.
It's an excellent location. I think the community.
I think so too, and I believe that the other people alone that didn't work. Rob and I are there all the time, so we're going. That's generally what I do. We're there, we run it until we're gone. So I agree too. Great parking lot. My last restaurant, we argued a little over parking. We don't have that anymore.
What would be your food mostly?
Say comfort food, but all my restaurants done ribs, seafood. But in my opinion. People are now looking to go out and have a good time and more appetizers and sandwiches, but we'll also have ribs, crab cakes, what we've always done, because people won't allow me not to and let me know about it. But in my opinion, people aren't looking for the big dinners anymore, special occasions, and, you know, that's what we're looking to do.
You have to excuse me, but I didn't hear anything about, have you attended any type of alcohol awareness or training?
Robin's taken all that. She's certified and...
Do we want to get her?
Many members of our staff.
We have that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. Mr. Hicks, on your application, it has current residence address, but where is that located, Ms. June Court, in Leonardtown?
Yeah, it's right there in Singletree.
Oakley Street.
Right across the school board.
So Robin's taking care of your training your employees, ensuring they're up to speed on sales.
Yeah, frankly, Robin pretty much takes care of everything.
And is this a conditional?
Nope, they are ready to roll.
Tammy's been wonderful, and we got it all worked out.
Very good to hear.
Chase, would you say your hours were going to be for lunch to dinner?
Yeah, 11 in the morning until, and maybe in the fall we'll start doing breakfast if we get enough staff.
And what time do you close?
9 or 10, maybe stay later. We have nice people. You know the routine.
You never close.
Approval on this application, how, when will you open then?
Well, I'm thinking tomorrow afternoon. It really, as far as just painting, it really wasn't a lot of work to do the building. With all the numerous owners that we discussed, they kept on fixing things. So finally I said, well, it looks like a good place to go now, because a lot of people spent a lot of money in there, and we just hope that this will work out for us, for the community. A lot of our support's from 7th District and Clements and their area, and they're great people, and we're really looking forward to being back. But we love people in Leonardtown, too.
It's basic.
Any other questions from the board?
Yes, sir. Where's your storage at? Are you going to use the same freezer area? Is that all you have? I don't see another storage area you got.
There's a walk-in and a freezer, but, I mean, they're inside entrances. Yeah.
Right. Just like it was in a full-size gun ad.
Correct. Right. They actually
had one beside it, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, two there.
Absolutely.
And I see one here, so.
Yep. Mm-hmm. We've changed colors more than we've changed anything.
Just want to make sure. Any other questions from the board? Again, on all applicants, members in the room, or the audience, do you, anyone oppose or support this application? Tammy, do we have anything?
Nothing in the office. Nothing via mail or phone.
All right. So, do I have a motion?
I make a motion for the approval of Bottom of the Hill Tavern. Application of Michael A. Hicks to purchase a Class B restaurant BWL license and trading as Bottom of the Hill Tavern, Bottom of the Hill Tavern LLC, 40874 Merchants Lane, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20601.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Ms. Curry, any discussion from the board? Quick and simple. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.
Well,
thank you.
Vote. Oh, man.
We need a vote. I'm sorry.
Bear with me.
We're getting there.
First day here.
Almost.
Trying to help you move things along. That last.
I was trying to get you out of here. All right. I apologize, truly. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Good night.
Take care of yourself, all right?
That changes every year.
I'm so sorry.
Take this over to the treasurer with your hard-earned cash, huh? Bye-bye.
Good luck.
Good luck.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Same deal.
Okay.
All right. What's next? The toasted pumpkin.
Okay, folks. Oh, sorry. Give me 1 second. Next application is the Toasted Foot Lounge, application of Robert V. Oler and Scott Reeves to purchase Class D BWL license and trading as the Toasted Foot Lounge, Southern Maryland Cigars, 20845 Callaway Village Way, Callaway, Maryland.
Also Callaway.
Please raise your right hands, gentlemen.
Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth? I state your names, please. Address.
Scott Ian Reeves.
Yeah, talk louder because we don't have a microphone.
Come on, have a seat.
Scott Ian Reeves, 23350 Pembroke Drive, Hollywood, Maryland, 20636.
Robert Vincent Oler, 48418 Princess Court, Lexington Park, Maryland, 20653.
Corey Williams Oler, 48418 Princess Court, Lexington Park, Maryland.
Mr. Oler, you said Vincent?
Yes, Vincent.
Sorry.
Okay. Sorry.
Thank you.
You're not on the application?
No, not, she's not on the application. I just thought it'd be good to bring her up since she's going to be managing the bar service area.
That's fine. He's bringing a manager for.
Yeah.
afternoon. What can you tell us?
Good afternoon. So first of all, thanks for in advance for your consideration for the Toasted Foot Lounge for Class D alcohol and beverage license in Southern Maryland. There really isn't any cigar lounges, obviously, in St. Mary's County or Southern Maryland area. There's you do have something across the bridge, that being the Tobacco Barn, and the next closest thing you have is, you know, 45, 50 miles north of here, Tinderbox in Waldorf. I have traveled all over the United States as an avid cigar smoker, and everywhere I go, I always go to the, you know, the first cigar lounge, and a lot of the areas I go to are surrounded by military installations, and I just constantly could not believe that we didn't have anything like that down here. And being the avid cigar smoker that I am, it's been a dream of mine for quite a number of years now to do that. So that's really our vision, and kind of our goal is to really be known as the premier cigar lounge in Southern Maryland. I'd like to kind of fast forward a little bit, if the board doesn't mind, and kind of talk a little bit about our operational strategy and how we intend to really control the sale of alcoholic beverage, because I think that's probably most germane to the board. But if you take a look at the floor plan, there is and it's not apparent necessarily on there, but there is a physical separation between the actual lounge itself, what we call the VIP lounge, and the retail area of the cigar shop itself. So the operational strategy really breaks into two parts, where you have retail cigar sales, premium cigar sales, and I'm not referring to grape cigars or anything like that, premium cigars only. And at some point, pipe tobacco, we'd like to get into that as well. And then the VIP lounge itself, where we'd like to serve the alcoholic beverages. In order to even enter the VIP lounge, which is physically separated from the rest of the lounge and also keypad access controlled for members only, you have to be a member. In order to be a member, you have to pay a fee and purchase a cigar locker in the lounge itself. Membership is annual, and as part of your membership, you're basically agreeing at that point that you are of legal drinking age, 21 and older. We do confirm ID at that point upon taking in the application. And each member can bring one guest as well into the lounge. The way we intend to manage that is kind of twofold. Number one, the member is signing a contract with us for their lounge membership, stating that if they were to bring someone under the age of 21 in, that they would be sacrificing basically their fee and their membership to the lounge. The second part is that our staff, via Mrs. Williams-Oler, and anyone that works in the bar, will be using 100% ID check with any guests of the lounge. Members, once again, are already verified. They've already signed a contract. We have their information on file. So that's that physical separation, that control of the alcohol in there, we thought was really kind of what sets us apart from any of the other cigar lounges I've been to. Many cigar lounges do not serve alcoholic beverages in the state of Maryland. However, as you get outside of the state of Maryland, it's quite common. But the ones that do in the state of Maryland, they do not have that separation. So I think that kind of sets us a little bit apart, and I think it definitely lends us to more of a controlled alcoholic beverage service environment. My wife, sitting to the 19 years to the right of me, has managed Ruby Tuesday, general manager of Ruby Tuesday, for over 10 years. So she has experience there. She's managed the one here locally when it first opened, prior to that in Baltimore, and then two other restaurants prior to that. She's attended all of the TIPS training, all of the alcohol awareness training. She's currently slated for the June 21st session, I believe. It's in Charlotte Hall. Mm-hmm. Yep. So in Charlotte Hall, she's going to attend that. Myself and Mr. Reeves are also planning to attend as well, so we will all be alcohol trained. Anything you can think to add?
I think we have a security system in place, monitoring both inside and outside. Yep. We'll have lock, store, key, in terms of the beverage control behind the bar and in the storage area. Yeah. So to Bobby's point, you know, I think the physical separation and the vetting process to even get back there is the key here.
And one other thing I'd also like to point out is while we are applying for a Class D tavern type license, I'd like the board, if you didn't already know, just to kind of keep in mind that there are certain rules, state mandated rules, as far as the sale of alcohol in conjunction with a tobacco shop, meaning that no more than 30% of our sales, our overall revenue, can even come from the sale of alcohol. So we're somewhat limited. I mean, alcohol is kind of, I don't want to call it a, you know, I don't want to use the term afterthought, but it's more of a convenience to complement the cigar sales while you're having a cigar, have a drink, have a bourbon or whatever. But by no means do not think of us as a, you know, full service alcohol first bar or tavern, because that's certainly not only is that not part of our operational strategy or our vision, but it's not even within, quite frankly, the law. We can't. So think of us more as a place where you come to have, you come after a day of work, or you show up on a weekend to watch a football game, you buy two or three cigars, you sit in a lounge, you sit back, relax, watch TV, and have a beer or two while you're there. Right now, we're looking at bottle service only, bottle beer service only, and, you know, some choice bourbons, choice scotches, you know, not too much of the run-of-the-mill stuff that you would find in a more full-service bar. So as far as you talked about security, sorry, I didn't jump on you there, but we look to have two cameras in the VIP lounge, one on the bar, one on the lounge overall, another camera up front in the retail area, and then a camera in the office itself, which is where we would have our safe and, of course, money. So that would be important there.
Will you have any food?
No, you're not allowed to. No. We do, what I did work out, kind of a soft arrangement, if you will, with Greg Calloway, who owns the Gridiron Grill and also owns the property there. We spoke. What we're going to try to, and I'm sorry I didn't include kind of the overall top floor plan there, if you will, or the layout of the area, but we are probably about 100, 150 feet from Gridiron Grill as far as walking distance, right adjacent, in other words. But worked out a deal with him where we can order food from the Gridiron Grill and they can just bring it right over. So it's kind of a win-win for him. He gets extra business as far as the food's concerned. His waiter or waitresses get tips as they bring it over, almost like a delivery service. And if you're sitting there in the lounge and you're feeling hungry, I mean, we'll have the menu there. You make a call and it's right there. That's also pretty common in most of the cigar lounges I've been to, where they have, because in Maryland, it's the absolute no-no as far as having food and tobacco, if you will, in the same space. But once you get outside of Maryland, especially south of Maryland, you'll see it actually quite frequent. So,
what's your capacity for the lounge? I count 40.
We have it set up there. We don't know exactly what the capacity is yet. We're waiting for the fire marshal. So as far as the building permits are concerned, we're in plan review right now. The only thing that we're waiting on is the health department to sign off as far as they just wanted to see our plan. The plan we originally submitted was missing one sink. We now have that in the plan. So I imagine we'll have that sign off soon. And then we're waiting, then the fire marshal waiting for them. So.
All right. So you need the health department still and the fire marshal?
Correct.
Is the interior sprinkled?
It is not.
It is not?
It is not.
Is that going to be a requirement?
Not that I'm aware of.
Sprinkler system.
Right. Not that I'm aware of.
Because the concern would be that there's only one way in or out.
There's a rear entrance as well.
Right.
That's going to be our fire exit. It's currently the fire exit.
That would be into the hallway there?
Yes.
Okay, there's one there.
There's one way, one in the back and one in the front, the main entrance.
You're talking about the lounge.
The lounge itself, yeah.
Yeah, so what we intend to do, and I apologize once again, this is kind of small.
You're talking front and back of the, if you're in the lounge itself.
You have two exits.
There's two entrances or exits.
Yeah.
Okay. My concern there, though, is it a requirement, or do you know from the fire marshal whether it has to be sprinklered?
I do not know if it needs to be sprinklered. When I did talk to the fire marshal, it was actually the conversation with the fire marshal's office that led me to create that door there in the back. We didn't actually have that door in the back of the lounge at first, but he pointed out the fact that you need to have that easy means of egress, and you certainly couldn't have. He said the worst case scenario would be you had someone back there but in the lounge closer to the bathroom, and there was a fire up front, and they had to actually run through the fire to get out of the back. So that was why we actually added the back door right there. There was no mention of sprinkler system.
I do know that that would be certainly something with land use and growth management. I don't know, perhaps this location is grandfathered where they do not have to have sprinklers in that building. But I do know, and I think, that it's a requirement now, I believe,
for commercial locations. I don't know, is there anybody on the board that knows?
That would be taken care of by the fire marshal. He won't get his approval without it.
Without the fire marshal, okay.
Correct.
Okay.
My only question for you would be, so you have manager, you're going to be there while it's in operation.
Yes.
Who's going to be behind the bar in the members only area?
Primarily during the day, myself.
Okay.
And then it will be staffed on the weekend.
Because that's behind a key code access location, is there staff out in the main retail area?
Yes.
Yeah, we'll always have a minimum of two staff members, one in the lounge, one outside the lounge.
So no time will a member be in the lounge with a guest without staff in there?
That's correct. That's at no time.
Yes.
Right.
No access to alcohol while they're in there.
Absolutely not.
How about a member being in the lounge without staff being in there?
There's no plan for that to be. There's no reason we would have a member in there without staff in there.
Okay.
Always at least two people minimum is our plan.
So as long as there's people in the lounge, there will be a manager in there. Correct.
There will probably be a manager in there regardless of whether there's someone in the lounge. Quite frankly, we have it staffed to be that way. Minimum Monday through Thursday, we're going to have at least, you know, three people in the store at all times, and on weekends probably four. So there would never be an opportunity.
What will your hours be then?
We're looking for Monday through Thursday to be 11 a.m. to about 9 p.m. And then Friday and Saturday, we were going to go 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. And Sunday would be 12 p.m. to 8 p.m.
And for the benefit of the new board members, Class Ds and Class Bs are both automatically on-off sale, which means they can obviously consume on-premise, but they can also sell product off-premise. Now, in speaking with you, you guys had absolutely no interest in that.
No.
So they would be self-limiting themselves to on-sale only.
Well, I'm sure your alcohol is going to be your enticement to come in and enjoy it with a particular brand or a different cigar or something like that. That's right. The whole flavor.
The compliment. It is. That's right.
Compliment, mm-hmm. Correct.
Yeah, most mm-hmm. often what's done in areas north of us, if you will, in Maryland, is BYO, which is obviously a no-no here, and Tame and I talked about that at length. So that's why we're looking to get the approval for the alcohol and beverage license.
The Class D for the state of Maryland is a requirement. If you have a cigar lounge, is that correct? Then you must purchase a Class D license, is that correct?
We don't have this is a round peg in a square hole or a square peg in a round hole. We don't have cigar lounge. We don't have specialty licenses in St. Mary's County. So I called both Calvert and Charles County. The Tinderbox in Charles County has what they call a dinner theater license. It's a Class D license, but it's a dinner theater license. In Calvert County, they use a D license, which is a bar license, which is the only thing. If they cannot serve food, then it has to be a D.
But you're going to self-restrict on the sale of any off-premise alcohol for the retail area. There's not going to be any of
no
that.
Interest.
Right?
No interest at all.
And with restaurants, for the new members' benefit, with restaurants and bars, whether the applicant self-restricts, it does not, even if the applicant doesn't, does not mean that the board cannot restrict a license for that. Okay?
Okay. All your alcohol storage behind the bar area?
Behind the bar, and if you look in the back right hand, there's a storage, lock storage area back there. Any overflow, that's where we would keep.
No, through the far corner, right corner, right?
That's what I'm talking about. Yep, sorry, far right corner, yep.
As a non-member, I'm allowed to just come in there and smoke and drink too?
As a non-member, you can actually come in and you can only access the front retail area there and the humidor itself. You can't even come into the members' lounge without being a member, unless a member brought you in as a guest. I think early on we'd like to at least allow people to come back and take, you know, get the lay of the land, so to speak, but, you know, to try to entice them into becoming members, but the plan would be, you know, once again, members only and guest members.
Up against this wall here, is that three big screen TVs you're going to have in there?
On the right-hand side, right-hand side, correct, yes.
Yep. Yes.
That is correct.
Yes.
Yeah, three 60-inch TVs and then one 60-inch TV behind the bar. It may be kind of hard to see. That's actually a 72-inch cooler that we're looking to put below there for your beer. Yeah, so.
Watch TV as a non-member.
Question. The health department, within businesses, the interior businesses, I thought smoking was disallowed.
This is for a cigar lounge, and the health department has special regulations just for the cigar lounges. I think you explained a little better than I could in regards to the whole, anybody walking into a cigar lounge has the purpose of going there to smoke or be exposed to smoke, and that's the
right public area where
right.
People,
right.
Not like going to an Outback Steakhouse to
where
have
it would
steak
be
and
passively
smoke.
Right.
Okay.
No one's surprised when they're exposed.
But they're only allowed to smoke within the members only lounge part of it.
You could actually smoke in both parts.
In both parts of it.
With the tobacconist license, which we have, you can. I mean, you can smoke indoors. That's not even an issue. So no issues there. We
so
just wanted to control the alcohol.
The only restriction is the alcohol in the VIP lounge.
Sorry.
The members
no
only. I'm sorry.
Correct.
So will you allow people to smoke cigarettes then in the VIP lounge?
Absolutely not.
Nope.
And that's not a law or anything there.
Right,
that,
but
that's personal.
That's
kind of the unwritten rule of cigar lounges. We're kind of on the fence on the whole vaping thing, to be honest with you. We've been talking about that, but the cigarettes definitely not.
Didn't know that many people smoke cigars.
So you didn't realize that many people?
Truly, I didn't.
Be surprised. Everyone we've talked to so far in this process, whether it be even Mr. Morris over at the health board, the bank vice president, everyone we talked to along the way, we find out either they do currently smoke cigars or they'd actually like to come by and, or they have friends that do.
Yes. Spend a few moments at the tinderbox and
right.
You'll see how many people.
Well, exactly.
That is how this was created.
You're exactly right, Miss Curry.
Yep.
Well.
I have a question.
Sure.
I'm dying to find out, how did you come up with the name The Toasted Foot?
Thank you.
It's actually a great question. it's fairly well known among avid cigar smokers that when you go to light your cigar, it's actually referred to as toasting the foot of the cigar. So that's actually why we stayed with that name, because those that smoke cigars, you know, it kind of goes without saying that that's exactly what you're referring to. But all of the people that don't, that's the first thing
like
they
me.
Ask. They're kind of intrigued, you know. Our lawyer, Miss Wood, who used to be here, I think you guys all know her as well, she said the same thing. She's like, well, I would never go to a place that would call the Toasted Foot because she doesn't like feet. But we're hoping that she's an anomaly and that won't turn everyone else away.
Okay.
Now, even though Ms. Oler's not on the application, I just want to get clarification. You have extensive restaurant and or alcohol service experience along with training of personnel.
Previously certified, and I'll be recertified next week, yes.
And you'll be doing that with your staff?
Yes, I will.
How many days are they allowed as a conditional?
Up to 90. It's a new application.
What is it?
Up to 90 days.
Up to 90 days, yeah.
Yes. Yes. They don't have any of their inspections.
Right. Yeah, we're only looking to start construction next week. So we
they haven't done the build out yet.
So you want the 90 then, yeah.
Right. So we're going to 90-day conditional
at least,
approval?
Right.
It's not a great deal of construction required. We're just moving a couple walls around, really. But nevertheless, we're not quite ready.
If you get it done before 90 days, you know, you can, it's fine.
I hope.
And if you need extra time,
days.
You need to come in and get an extension.
But I appreciate it.
But you saw the first one we had today with the walk-in box.
Yeah.
Times already. So.
Yeah, exactly.
We get to be great friends here.
Would you all consider security cameras on the exterior?
I'd be open to it. I didn't. It wasn't something we thought of because we never intended to have anyone outside.
Mm-hmm.
you know, so you're kind of almost doubled in. Number one, you're in the lounge. You're not even in the exterior part of the store.
And right, right.
We don't have any plan. And actually, as part of our lease with Callaway Rentals over there, we're not allowed to even have people really outside. So I think written approval is required if you wanted to do something like that. But if you actually look at the space, there's really, unless you're going to be in the parking lot, which we're obviously not going to be, there's not a whole lot of space behind the location, mm-hmm. even if we wanted to have a few people out there with mm-hmm. a couple of chairs. I think it'd be great, but in this particular location doesn't really lend itself to that. So.
You're all the way at the very end of the building, is that correct?
We are actually, if you were to drive in, you've got actually two buildings on the left-hand side there. So you got A&W, two buildings on the left-hand side. On the very end building, we're right there. And we're not on the very end, we're actually on the closer end.
Middle side.
A lot of people don't realize there's actually a separation between those. It's not one.
Right, right, right.
There's a separation. We're on that end.
Yeah, I went looking for it yesterday, and I said, it's got to be one of these right here.
Yep, 2A is the actual location.
Now, understanding that I think there's going to be a lot of interest. You're going to have people coming into the retail space wanting to see your members' lounge and get a tour of it and so forth. You're going to restrict that. Even though they're not becoming members, you're still going to restrict that to no 18, 19, 20-year-olds that will enter the lounge.
Correct. Correct.
Time frame, correct.
Yep.
It is keypad access, so
yeah. They, but they would be with you. The person would be with you.
Correct.
But
yes.
You've stated in here 21 and older, so when you're going to, I think you'll have interest in the beginning.
Right.
17, 18-year-old walks in, you're not allowing them to go into that space.
That's correct.
Yeah, and that 17 or 18-year-old would also keep in mind that, you know, it's a $250, $300 annual membership.
Sure.
Cigars are $10 to $12 a piece. I mean, mm-hmm. these aren't things that 17 or 18-year-olds typically have the financing.
And your 17-year-olds aren't allowed by law to smoke anyway.
Right. Exactly.
Or drink.
Anybody else? Any questions?
We have a RAS class. You know what that class is? Responsible alcohol service training is coming up in July. Y'all plan to attend that? Or
yes, Ms. Hildebrand told me about that when I first, a couple times I've come in about that you guys are offering that, and we need to look to take that or the TIPS class, whichever one you guys think is the best.
State is required, which would be TIPS, TAM, Serve Safe, that mm-hmm. you know, RAST. This month, you're just under the wire in regards to requirement by licensees. July 1, applicants would be required to go.
Okay.
Okay. But we still offer it. It's great for employees. It's supplemental to the state training.
Yeah.
It's St. Mary's specific.
I guess speaking for myself and Mr. Reeves here, knowing that we don't have that background that my wife does, you know, in the food service and alcohol beverage service industry, we'd probably look to take something like that.
Right. Very good.
It's all for the safety of our community. It's compliant. So, having no other questions from the board.
I was wondering what other conditions other than health and fire?
The health department and state fire.
Who's everything for is UNO, health, fire, UNO, and alcohol awareness. Because they're scheduled but not completed yet.
Ms. Curry, I would like to condition this also on the fact that as Class D, that it's restricted for on-site sale of alcohol only. Correct.
Do that
and
during.
You can put that in the motion.
I think they're self-imposing as well, and that would
sure.
be part of their application.
Yeah, we have no use for it. Once again, we really can't sell that much alcohol anyway. So any other means to sell is not going to help us. You know.
That way it'll be on record.
Yep.
Yeah.
Understood.
Any other questions from the board?
I did.
Having none, members of the audience, does anybody have any protest and or support of this application? Hearing none, do we have a motion?
I'd like to make a motion for the Toasted Foot Lounge that we approve the application of Robert V. Olger and Scott Reeves to purchase a Class D beer, wine, liquor license, and trade as a Toasted Foot Lounge, Southern Maryland Cigars, LLC, 20845 Callaway Village Way, Callaway, Maryland, 20620. This is a 90-day conditional license pending health, fire, UNO, alcohol awareness, and the notice that this is restricted to sales only.
Very good. Do we have a second?
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Good luck.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
For your time.
Good luck to you.
Good luck. Thank you.
I think it'll be an excellent adventure.
See you there.
As you move along, come in the office, all right?
Thank you, Ms. Curry.
Thank you.
Sunset Cove.
Next order of business is going to be premise changes. First is Sunset Cove, Joseph Salbo, and Samantha Irwin. Request an extension of premise and extra serving counter for July 1st and 2nd boat docking contest. Please step forward.
Hello. Raise your right hand, please. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Please have a seat. If you would, one at a time, state your full name and your home address, please.
I'm Joseph Salvo, and my address is 17348 Whitaker Court, St. Indigo's, Maryland.
Samantha Irwin, 48660 Wynn Road, Ridge, Maryland, 20680.
How are you all doing today?
Good.
Good, thank you.
If you would, explain your request.
Let me see how I can. Basically, it's a boat docking contest. We own the marina, Point Lookout Marina, and it's a boat docking contest. What they do is actually move from a slip to back into another slip, and it's basically ran by timing. And you know, the fastest boat, of course, wins the prizes, which is money, I guess, and other various things.
Explain your plan. What's your plan of action here?
Okay. Where our restaurant is, which is Sunset Cove, as you come into the marina. I think we provided you with a little map there.
You did.
As you come in, we're going to have all that blocked off. So basically, we're asking for extended premises so that we can let them buy beer only down in the lower parking lot, which is adjacent to the restaurant and the office. The boat docking contest itself is going to be on the front. As you come in, you have the water side that runs along with the piers. So we're going to put bleachers in that parking lot and extend that premise out. So we're basically asking to be able to serve alcohol a little bit outside of the restaurant area into the parking lot.
What time frame?
Asking Friday from 3 till 9 and then Saturday from 10 till 6.
What time was it on Saturday?
10 till 6.
6.
10 to
6.
6. 6. And Friday it was 3 to what?
3 till 9.
Where's the Cabana Bar located?
It's in the back of the it sits off the left side of the deck of the restaurant, on the back side, on the water side.
So you're requesting Ms. Irwin just to serve beer only?
Just beer out in the parking lot area.
I'm sorry?
The restaurant itself, Sunset Cove, already has a permit for that whole area, the grassy area by the Cabana Bar and the outside deck, already permitted to serve everything there. We're asking for beer. We'd like to set a beer truck up down in the parking lot of the restaurant. But all that will be blocked off so nobody can take that
outside of that little area.
There's a fence, okay.
See where
you'd have, the beer truck serving beer.
Correct.
But they'd also be able to buy mixed drinks at the Cabana Bar.
Correct.
And circulate within the restricted area.
Which they can now.
Okay.
The day of the event will also be the local rescue squad will be there, and the fire company, local fire company, will also be at the event for safety reasons, plus for, you know, to raise money for their services and stuff also.
So as I look at this map, you come down to the end of the road, you take a right to go over to the Bluestone and what looks like a workshop area, that's where your event parking is going to be. Everything away from the cove, basically.
Yes.
Correct? Okay.
You're going to come into Miller's Wharf and you'll turn right.
Right, in a vehicle.
That's a whole, that's kind of where our land storage is now and, okay. and parking for the marina and all. So all that will be parking. Right in front of that little area, that'll be roped off so that people can't take alcohol out of that area.
That'll be,
and go up.
Will that be your security checkpoint, basically?
Correct. Yes. Okay. ID checkpoint.
ID security?
Yes, sir.
At that location?
There will be wristbands for underage and for of age.
I think I read where you had one color for those who are allowable to drink.
Yes.
Then one color, or a clear color, or white, or something along those lines for all other attendees.
Yes.
Okay. I think that leads into my next question, where you have, so there will be no vehicles past that gate area where it says temporary asphalt and then temporary change, Bluestone. That's what you're looking for the expansion of, so that everybody can stand along the water line and watch the event?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are there any other check security gates or any other staffing?
Well, actually, we're going to have staffing at the beginning of each dock that would let you into that area so that we also could monitor what comes off of the docks.
That was my concern.
Because a lot of people will try to get on the very ends of the docks and kind of sneak in. So we've already allowed for that. That's, I think, part of what the fire company is going to help us out with. And some of the other volunteer groups, the Legion and people like that that have volunteered to help, and of course our own staff.
So anybody in your area will have a band. If they're not, then they're going to be ID'd and checked and so forth.
Yes.
Nobody without a band.
Right. Or they'll have to leave.
I mean, it's a boat docking contest. You're going to have people show up via water.
Right.
Okay.
Do you have an idea of how many people for this event?
We're estimating about 500.
Wow.
We hope it would be that good.
That's just kind of based on other. We've sent staff to other boat docking contests in the area, Chris Field, Solomon's, and Brooms Island, and that's roughly about what the crowd runs. So we're hoping.
Well, you're confident though that you have enough parking for that size crowd?
Yes, sir.
Yes. We have.
To your neighbors, then, is this property that's owned by Joan Mullen?
Okay, she no longer has that property.
Okay, is that a field? Is it?
No, that is a home right there.
Is there a way to that's blocked from?
Yes,
people won't be able to park over there.
Yes, well, they won't be able to park because they have a driveway that comes in. They would have to come through the person's driveway to even get into that property to us.
I see.
But actually, we have a fence in that area that we're already designated in, which backs up to that property. Mm-hmm. It's in place for even when we serve on the back deck or the Cabana Bar area, so that people cannot walk out into their properties.
Okay. Are they aware of this event?
Pretty much everybody in the area has, yes.
Knows about it?
We actually had applied last fall for the event.
Bridge is a pretty big place, you know.
Yes.
Not Millersburg Road, though.
We actually applied last fall for the same event, and of course the hurricane came and we canceled the event. So pretty much the people in the community are excited, and they know that we're doing it again this July, so.
Well, I have a concern because of the dock that collapsed in Solomon's 3 weeks ago from a wedding party. Is there a limit as to how many people can be on your docks? Is there going to be a sign? Is there somebody controlling it?
Well,
I mean, has it been inspected? Can it hold the amount of people that might be on there?
Well, they're all insured for one, of course. The other.
Is there a limit as how many people can be on them?
I have never seen that.
No, there's not, but we're going to restrict the docks to whatever boats are on that particular dock. There's only really two docks that are going to come into play because of
that's
the proximity to where the viewing area is. A dock, which
actually is a brand
is
new
brand
dock.
Is brand new. It's a two-year-old dock.
That's what I was wondering. Yes. You know,
but if there's 20 boats on the dock, you know, we're not going to let 100 people go on that dock because those 20 people have paid for the space to see the docking.
Okay,
content.
Just as long as it's some sort of control
yeah.
for the numbers
yes.
of people that are out there.
Yeah, we'll
okay.
definitely control
thank you.
That.
Excellent question. Based on your estimation of 500 people, what do you have for security staff or event staff are you going to have there?
Well, basically, it'll be most of our staffs from, we own a few marinas, so it'll be mostly all our employees. And then again, like I say, the fire company and the rescue squad are also going to be policing the area. And we have a few police officers that we know that are not going to be on duty that'll be there just in case.
Well, the rescue squad won't be policing the officer. I mean, the area.
No, they won't.
No,
of course.
Just be
but
there
they'll also know when they see something that's not okay. safe or if anything were to happen. You know.
I think for an event like this, I hope you have adequate security. There should be enough.
Yes.
For that kind of people.
And I also
there's quite
do
a few areas they can all be walking and doing things, so.
Also do have cameras on the restaurant itself that will be viewing, you know, what's
mm-hmm.
going on.
Mm-hmm.
So.
We really feel like we have enough staff. And like Joe had said earlier, we do have a bunch of individuals, probably about 20, 25 coming from the American Legion. Which is right down the street, that are going to, you know, station on the docks as well as security. So, I mean, it has been addressed. We don't have an exact number, but.
I understand. I guess my concern comes into when you open up the space and you have obviously a lot of folks moving back and forth, who's responsible for the alcohol sales? Who's actually handling it? Are they trained? Are you going to have the right staff there? This beer truck comes into the location. Who's manning the beer truck?
The beer truck, I do believe that it, now I'm not sure because our general manager for the restaurant is not here, but there was talk of Budweiser was going to be the truck of choice, and they were going to man it with their people, that truck.
I understand if there's a violation with that truck. Not the truck's responsibility.
No, it's not their responsibility.
No,
it's Sunset
right.
Coast's
okay.
responsibility.
Or if somebody sends somebody up there to buy beer for a minor that's, you know, underage person, there needs to be some sort of checking for that
well,
beer.
Well, we also have our trained bartenders that have been through
they're
all the
be
classes.
They're going to be in the bar at the other end. We're talking about the beer truck.
We
all know how accessible beer trucks are.
Quite a few bartenders, though,
yeah.
from
okay.
both restaurants.
Well, the bar, the truck, if it's, say, it's Budweiser, they're going to bring their own people who are going to be pouring the beer, okay? And they're going to be responsible for checking.
They have to, Budweiser, you can rent the truck.
Right.
But
and I could
you
be
guys
wrong.
Are responsible for pouring.
Right.
Exactly. Right.
Well, then we'll
that's
have
the
our
only point I'm trying to make.
Yeah.
So they're responsible for
yes.
the person who does the pouring. And checking the IDs on the beer truck.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll make sure that happens.
Well, then again, the beer trucks will also be fairly, they're going to kind of be in the middle of the event. So if somebody were to try to even, pretty much by that time, I would hope our security is going to catch somebody without the wristband.
Right.
And, of course, they wouldn't get served anyway if they didn't have it.
And in Budweiser's defense, they are also licensed by the state, so they, too, can be, you know what I mean? They should know the rules as well.
Sure.
But still, you at the end of the day, it's on
We're
you.
We're responsible, yes.
Any conditions, understand?
Yes, we still need health permit, which you said you're going to have somebody from the health department notify me.
Yes.
There was no requirement for a special event permit because I do have a note here from Harry Knight from Land Use and Growth Management that boat docking does not require a permit as it's considered an accessory use to a marina, okay, via the zoning regs. So it's an outdoor event, so there's really no issue with the fire marshal that nobody's being confined in any spaces that need to be escaping from anything. So it's just the health for, like, the porta potties and the other items that, you know, if you do have, you have a health permit for the cabana bar, you know, Bud truck is probably disposable cups.
Right.
And they'll get something once they get that. So you... 30 days, you know.
So we're doing 30-day conditional on this?
That's unless you think you need more.
The event's July 2nd.
Yeah, so there you go.
We need more words.
So your conditional would be to July 2nd. Well, yeah. Actually, we have another meeting, so it can be July 1st. I'm sorry. Your conditional would be to the date of the event.
Right.
If they don't have that health permit by then or that health letter to me by then, it's...
And that's the way the condition is satisfied.
Correct.
Just a letter to you, right?
Correct.
Okay. Any other questions from the board? Members in the audience, again, do anyone here protest or support this application for extension of premise? Tammy, you've covered everything, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the premises change for Sunset Cove, Joseph Salvo, and Samantha Irwin, requesting an extension of premise and extra serving counter for July 1st and 2nd for a boat docking contest. This is conditional on the health to July 1st.
Excellent. Thank you. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Curry. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Motion carried. You're approved.
Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Good weather.
Okay. I'm sure you're going to have fun.
Okay. Just want to be successful.
Okay. Next order of business. The officer member trade name changes, Plaza El Teca, removing Miguel Lopez and adding Antina L. Lopez.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Lopez passed away, so his wife is now taking over the that side of the license.
Hmm.
So. I'll make a motion from Plaza El Teca to remove Miguel L. Lopez and adding Antina L. Lopez.
Do we have
a second?
Any discussion?
Who's second?
Ms. Palczynski. Seconded.
Thank you.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Motion carried.
Is there anything here?
Just for the chair.
Just for the chair.
Thanks, sir. Mm-hmm. Next order of business is name change for Hampton Inn, removing Kimberly Oss.
Ms. Oss is no longer in the employ of Hampton Inn. However, they do have another licensee that does retain St. Mary's County residency, so there was no need to substitute anyone for Ms. Oss. So it's just a removal.
Do we have a motion?
I make a motion for the for Hampton Inn for the removal of Kimberly Oss.
Second.
Mr.
Hall.
Thank you. Oh, yes, please vote. Sorry.
Well, we need a vote.
We need a vote.
Vote, yes. Yeah.
Did we get it? Did we get a vote?
Oh, did we get a vote? No, we did.
No. We've got a vote for Azteca, but not Hampton, yes.
Okay. Yeah, we need one for Hampton.
All right. I apologize. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried. Other business, Board Administrator, Ms. Hildebrand.
Just like to say welcome to the new board members, and thank you to the board members who have left either because of their term or not a reappointment. They were wonderful people, and they definitely had a different effect on this board. So you guys have big shoes to fill, but so far, so good, okay? I think we're going pretty good. The only thing down on the board areas, we're going to be gearing up. I gave you all new copies of your quote-unquote, Article 2B. Can't promise a print copy anytime soon, more than likely, possibly next year, okay? But this being said, with the reorganization of Article 2B, becoming now the alcohol beverages article, it's got its own article, is going to require lots of changes on our forms. Everywhere that's referenced Article 2B, section whatever, has to be now changed to the new section and code. Also, our rules and regs, anywhere it references Article 2B, will have to be updated. And of course, we've had our own legislation passed, so those items will have to, we haven't, with all the changes and everything going on, we really haven't had a time to sit down and discuss how to implement these and put some language together for you guys to approve or disapprove or talk about. So we are working on that. Normally you would get your new list by this time of year, but we had a few that were a little bit late, our May people picking up their licenses in May, and then the treasurer's office had, I think she was sick or something. So we just got our monthly report this week, so next month you'll have your new updated list, okay? And of course, instructions on how to use that list. But other than that, is there anything else I was supposed to talk about? I think that's it. We have a RAS training at the end of July. That's it from me, short and sweet. And for a change, right?
Corporal Stone?
Through the month of May, I didn't get a chance to complete my monthly report. I had project graduation all last week where we, between Riken, Leonardtown, Great Mills, and Chopchicon High School, each night we got them to the college from the college to Pax River Base where they participated in project graduation. Still a large number of kids attend the event, and it was successful. Only one injury the entire week with one of the students, which is really good. We had a sobriety checkpoint on May 27th in Charlotte Hall in the area of Three Notch Road and Charlotte Hall School Road, and there were no DUIs out of it. There were a few vehicles stopped for suspicion of DUI. However, completing the field sobriety test, they were deemed not to be impaired. And not much to report for this month. I just want to talk to you guys a little bit about service to impaired patrons is nationally, it's an issue at businesses where people are being overserved by the bartenders. And not only at the MELA meeting in May, they talked about it, but through the National Liquor Law Enforcement Association, one of their big things are stepping up is increased enforcement to what's called SIPS program, S-I-P-S, Sales to Intoxicated Patrons. And what I'm going to present to my supervisors of the agency is to have police officers in undercover capacity go into businesses and look for people being served visibly impaired. It doesn't have to be where they someone's in, they're continuing to be served to the point of impairment. It's if they come in and first drink, if they're visibly impaired, is the bartender has a responsibility to say, no, I cannot serve you, or intervene in a certain way, or business intervene. And I think it doesn't happen at all bars. Occasionally it does happen, and it goes unnoticed. But you know, for enforcement strategies-wise, I think it's important for us to get out to do it, especially during the summertime. So there should be increased enforcement going on through the summer months into the rest of the year. If you guys have any questions on that, you can contact me for additional information on it. And also, Tammy had mentioned about the RAS training coming up in July. I think it would be a perfect opportunity for the new board members to attend. One, to have firsthand knowledge of what the rules and regulations entail, what we're teaching license holders, employees, or people who are trying to get the alcohol industry, ways to prevent violations. And just a little background to RAS training is, when I first took over alcohol enforcement back in 2009, myself and Tammy were going over different things. I had a lot of violations I was bringing businesses on. And I felt like, you know, a lot of the businesses were having violations because they didn't know all the rules and regulations. And therefore, we thought it was important to do a training. And we went to Montgomery County. They have a training out there called Alert Training. And they require all their licensees and employees to attend that training. And it's a monthly training that I do. They do twice a month.
Twice a month.
And so it really opened the eyes to a lot of business owners locally who've attended it. They think it's very successful in avoiding violations on premises. And also during the thing, there's a lot of questions and answers and participation from the audience. So you have a different view of what questions they have. So you can see what the interpretation of some of the employees of businesses are. But if you guys can attend that, let me know and see about making an arrangement to do a personal RAS training for you guys. If you guys are interested in that, just extending my hand on that, as well as congratulations for being picked by the governor to be a part of the alcohol board. And just to top off about Aaron Mathis, he was an amazing board member for the Alcohol Beverage Board since he was a part of this. Not only did he participate within the board meetings, he prepared for the meetings. He was very diligent in his actions that he took, as well as he would show up to different community meetings that I had, regardless if it was part of alcohol enforcement or not. It was a tobacco presentation that I've done where he attended as a community meeting, as well as several other events where he went above and beyond his duties on the board, and it shows how much he cared about the community. And I really wish him the best of luck in his future endeavors. So I just want to put that out there.
Here, here.
Excellent. And other than that, that's it. So congratulations, guys.
Corporal Stone, do you have alcohol enforcement at the Crab Festival this weekend? Or is there just going to be enough sheriff's deputies?
If they have security there, I'm not a part of that security detail. This Friday night, I'm going to be going to Leonardtown Pub. They're having an outdoor event there. And last month, the board had asked me to go make contact prior to the event to make sure everything's safe. So that's the only real responsibility I have for leading into this weekend. So, but that's it, yeah. Hopefully the Crab Fest stays controlled and no one's too out of control there.
So. Excellent. Thank you. Mr. Thompson?
Yes, sir. For the month of May, first of all, I'd like to say congratulations to our new board member and chairman.
Thanks, sir.
But for the month of May, I inspected 13 establishments, did 4 follow-ups, and did also 1 re-inspection beside the usual calls of to resolve non-compliances. While inspecting, I also did the normal paperwork and checking on the signage of our licensees. Also attend the Mailer Conference, in which I spoke for the need of some type of training for statewide for our inspectors in the state of Maryland. There was no chance for myself and Corporal Stone for the month of May to inspect together. We're starting away and trying to inspect together a few places, but then we're planning to do something maybe this month we can go together and inspect.
Excellent. Thank you, sir.
All right, well.
And the Licensed Beverage Board Association.
Good afternoon.
How are you doing, sir?
Good. My name is David Dent. I'm here on behalf of the St. Mary's County Licensed Beverage Association. I'd also like to extend congratulations and welcome to the new chairman and new member.
Thank you very much.
The board has been gracious enough in the past to allow our association to have a few minutes at the meeting to talk about things that are topical for the retailers in the county. Mm-hmm. So, you know, hopefully that will be able to continue, you know, with your permission. Mainly what we do is we try to liaison between with Tammy and the Alcohol Board, and we also work with the Community Alcohol Coalition to try to, you know, make sure that our association members and all retailers or anybody involved in the retail alcohol business are responsible. We try to keep you updated when there's legislation in Annapolis that concerns alcohol. We advocate during the legislative period. We also work with the board, as the previous board members know. We try to coordinate any legislation through the board, or try to help the board if they have any legislation that needs to get passed. This last year was a good example. We had 5 pieces of legislation that we were able to pass, and I believe all those take effect July 1st. Other than that, I don't really have anything to report on today. Summertime's a little bit, everybody's usually pretty involved with their businesses. So we had a meeting Tuesday at Anderson's Bar, when our local affiliate, our local county meeting. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to be there. I had a previous appointment. But when we have those meetings, we encourage anybody from the board to attend. Usually, if Tammy's available or Corporal Stone's available, they'll stop by. It's a good time for retailers just to have informal conversations with, you know, the administrative staff. In the past, we've had members stop by. Mr. Hall's been to our meetings before. I think Betty's been to a meeting as well. Mr. Thompson will make a meeting once in a while, so you guys are more than welcome. I know there's laws about, you know, too many board members being at a meeting, but, you know, we'd appreciate if you had an opportunity to stop by. We're probably going to suspend our meetings for the next 2 months, just because all the retailers are really super busy with the businesses, but we'll probably start again in the fall in September, and I'll make sure that we make the board aware of when and where those meetings are. We try to have them at a different member's location once a month is how we usually do it. But if anybody doesn't have any questions, that's about all I have to report today.
Okay. Great. Very good.
Thank you very much, sir.
I'm looking forward to it. Yeah. Thank you for your service.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
And Lauren from the Community Alcohol Coalition had told me she was not going to be able to make it today. So.
Anything else?
Motion to
adjourn. Motion for adjourn.
Welcome. You're going to come back.
I'm going to come back. Just a few procedural things, but I'm looking forward to it. So do we do a motion to adjourn?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
Vote. As in all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
We're adjourned.
Thank you.